Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. My name Ahmad from UST Malaya. I read blogs, including your blog. A few years back, they talk about Kedah to reclaim Penang. What is your opinion to? Thank you so much.
In the first agreement between the British and the Sultan of Kedah, the British agreed to pay every year 6,000 silver dollars, 6,000 Spanish dollars. These are coins made of silver, very valuable, 6,000 Spanish dollars. Subsequently, the British took province Wellesley and agreed to pay to the Kedah government 4,000 Spanish dollars. This totals, of course, 10,000 Spanish dollars. And during the time when the British were here, initially they paid the Kedah government with Spanish dollars, solid silver coins. Subsequently, the British decided to print their money. They set up a board of currency and they printed the money on paper, and they paid the Kedah government with this paper money, which of course is not as valuable as the Spanish dollar. And when we became independent, this agreement was carried forward so that the federal government pays the Kedah government 10,000 ringgit a year. 10,000 ringgit a year. That is less even than the salary of many civil servants here. 10,000 a year. Actually, it is less than 1,000 ringgit a month. This is, I think, unfair, because Penang is a rich state, and actually it should pay more. It should in fact pay the same value as the 10,000 Spanish dollars. I did, and when I was about to step down, I did tell the Kedah government to make a request that the federal government pays in silver dollar or equivalent to the Kedah state government, which today would come to about several million dollars a year. But Kedah is very generous. They decided not to ask, and the federal government is even more generous by not wanting to pay. In addition, of course, Penang takes water from Kedah and does not pay any royalty to the Kedah state. Whereas when Malacca sourced its water from Johor, it had to pay 30 cents per thousand gallons. 30 cents per thousand gallons of raw water. This is much more than what Singapore pays to Johor for 10,000 gallons. They pay only 3 cents. So Malacca had to pay 10 times more for getting the water. But when Kedah gives water to Penang, Penang does not pay a single cent. So I think Kedah should actually make a request to be paid more fairly based on the actual agreement reached between the British and the Kedah government some 200 years ago, more than 200 years ago. That is to say, it should revalue the Spanish dollar so that it, you can quote it in ringgit and pay that amount to the Kedah government. But I don't think Kedah should try to take back Penang. He may not be able to swallow it. Thank you.
Thank you, Tun. Can we have the next speaker? Yes, sir. You.
Tun, my name is Wasiha Hassan. I'm from Cats Devilis Institute, which is a training organization. My question is, since 2008, the pattern of state and federal governments have changed because several states have fallen into different governments. Prior to that, it was quite easy to manage the state-federal relations because except for Kelantan, most of the states was under one government. Now we see rumblings, especially from Penang and other states which are in different governments, that the equitable distribution of the funds to their states are not as good as the other states which are ruled by the same government like Barisan. So in future this is going to be the pattern, and how do you think the distribution should be? Thank you.
I believe that the distribution of the wealth of the nation is not equitable. There are some states which are deserving of more support from the federal government than other states. This have got to be taken into consideration because the economic picture has changed tremendously. Where before we were almost all equally poor, now some are very rich, some are still very poor. So there should be a kind of a negotiation between the states and the center, and the center should accept that there is a difference in the distribution of wealth. And if that is done, I would say that the grounds are good for some changes in terms of the quantum of support on the per capita basis. You see, when a lot of people from the other state migrate to the center, to Kuala Lumpur. Kuala Lumpur at the time of independence had only 300,000 people. Today, Greater Kuala Lumpur has 7 million people. Obviously, if you go on a per capita basis, then Kuala Lumpur and Selangor would be given even bigger share of federal wealth. This is in addition to the wealth developed in Kuala Lumpur because it was chosen as a capital. So the other states are losing their people. They are getting less and less, or at least they're not growing as fast as Kuala Lumpur. So they will get less and less, proportionately less and less over time. So there again, there is a reason for re-examining the distribution of wealth between the central government and the state. Thank you.
Okay. Assalamualaikum. Good morning. Tun, my name is Hamisa. Currently, I think we are hearing those from Johor, you know, being fond of using the rhetoric of Bangsa Johor. I, coming from Penang, I think, you know, that rhetoric is really, you know, going towards segregation of Malaysia. Your thoughts on this, you know, I know it's just a rhetoric, but if we were to allow it, you know, it sort of makes us feel that mereka di Johor itu lebih hebat daripada mereka dari negeri-negeri lain. Apa pandangan Tun berkenaan dengan perkara ini? Terima kasih.
Well, the federal constitution does not allow for secession. We would like, of course, to call ourselves Malaysians and not Johorians, Kedahans and things like that, because it tends to break up the unity of the people. And when we break up, some of the rich states will be very well off, but the poor states will suffer very badly. Actually, we should promote the idea of being Malaysians rather than the idea of being people of the different states. Actually, the reason for Johor's prosperity is partly due to the federal government and of course partly due to being close to Singapore. Now, if the federal government is not very tolerant of Singapore investment in Johor, then Johor would not be able to prosper. But As you know, the federal government decided on the setting up of Iskandar, which is a special growth center, and Petronas decided to site its facilities, big facilities, petrochemicals and the rest, in Johor. Again, that contributes towards the wealth of Johor. And in order to compete with Singapore, we develop ports in Johor. Not because it is the best place, but because we want to attract some of the shipping from going to Singapore, going to Malaysia through Johor instead. So Johor has benefited tremendously from federal policies and federal investments in Johor. If it considers itself as a separate state and that they are Johorians, I think that is not justified, because the reason why we do not develop Port Klang, for example, and other ports in Malaysia is because we want to see Port of Tanjung Pelepas, Pasir Gudang, etc., to be able to compete with Singapore. And indeed, it was the federal government which promoted the Port of Tanjung Pelepas. Federal ministers went around the world to ask shipping lines to make use of Pasir Gudang and the rest. And a lot of the development of Johor actually is because of the federal government. Because we have to compete with Singapore, and geographically, Johor and Singapore are practically the same in terms of geography, so that what can be done in Johor, in Singapore, can be done also in Johor. This trend towards stressing state citizenship is not a very healthy trend. I wouldn't like to see it go beyond that. We are all the same. Nobody is superior to the other. We are all Malaysian.